Hi, my name is George, and today I'm going to be presenting my work regarding temporal blocking for wave propagation kernels with sparse off the grid sources. The motivation behind this work is our efforts for accelerating wave propagation kernels that are of practical interest through cache optimizations, and more specifically, we care about temporal blocking. So, enabling these optimizations is not always easy in practical applications because especially seismic imaging, our computations they consist of sparse over the grid operators, so we do not have only a stencil benchmark to care about. So there are applicability issues due to seismic imaging kernels, and in this work we'll be presenting an approach to overcome limitations and enable temporal blocking. The experimental results of our work show improved performance for a number of industrial level wave propagation kernels. We are probably all aware of the figure in the top right of the slide here. It's a seismic imaging exploration, and we know that in this wave propagation, stencils are everywhere, but we also have sources and we also have receivers. Over the past, there has been a lot of efforts on how to optimize stencils regarding from parallelism to cache optimizations and deploying on accelerators, like a lot of efforts in vast literature. However, here, what is differentiating us from the typical stencils that we have been working with the previous years is the source and receivers that are not aligned to the grid points, as you can see in the bottom right of this slide. And these non-conventional update patterns emerge in our stencil benchmarks. So how do we iterate through these points is usually through different iteration space than the ones that we use for our grid points. You can see here, and we can have here a better look at the off-the-grid nature of these operators, because you can see the discretization in a typical 2D example, and with the red points and the yellow points, the sources and the receivers respectively, as well as the orange points that are affecting, that are affected by those operators. These points are being affected and are aligned to the grid, so these are the sparse of the grid operators. So usually we iterate over the sources which have 3D coordinates in an indirect way to access this and scatter the injection to the neighboring points. This loop of sources is aligned in time but not in space. It's iterated through another structure that we iterate through each source. We get the points affected, well, depending on the type of injection most of the times, and through indirection we add the impact on the field. So applying cache optimizations now to these structures is straightforward for cases such as space blocking, because we just decompose the grid into block tiles, because we partition the iteration space into smaller blocks only for the space iterations. Data locality is improved, of course, and there are no problems because applying the source impact just after the stencil update kernels, the stencil kernel updates have been executed. There are no data dependencies that complicate this schedule. However, in the case where we have temporal blocking, what is temporal blocking? It's a cache optimization like space blocking, but it's extended to time dimension. So the data usage is extended to time dimension. We update grid points in the future when this is possible, depending on the space and time constraints in its kernel. There has been rich literature for that. Several variants have been implemented, and a lot of research has been done, ranging from simple schemes like the wave from the skewing approach that we're going to use as a proof of concept in our work, and more exotic schemes like diamonds, trapezoids, overlapped hybrid models. But now, what is the issue with the sparse off-the-grid operators, more specifically for the off-the-grid operators? The issue is that these data dependencies usually lead to violations when a temporal update is happening, because there's a different iteration space, not aligned with the grid iteration space. And so when a sparse operator exists in the boundary between space and time blocks for our grid points, the order of updates is usually not preserved. We cannot easily decide whether a sparse of the grid operators, you can see with the pointer here in my screen, that lives in the boundary between space and time, may be executed in the blue wave or the orange wave, for example, of temporal updates. If you execute it while the blue wave is on, then you may miss an injection while the orange wave will be executed in the future. But if you execute it in the future and not in the previous one, then you still will be missing an injection in previous computations in time. The way to solve this problem is to align these parts of the grid operators to the grid points, as you can see here in the right figure at the bottom of this slide, where there are no data dependency vectors crossing space-time boundaries. Let's see what is the methodology we came up with in order to solve this issue. So we developed a negligible cost scheme that pre-computes the source injection contribution and is able to align the data dependencies of the sparse operators to the grid points. This technique is applicable to other fields as well. However, our proof of concept will only use seismic imaging wave propagation kernels. The first step of our scheme is we iterate over the sources and we use a zero initialized grid to inject just for a few time steps. Of course, we make the hypothesis that sources are not zero. They do not have zero amplitude at any point. So after we have done this injection, we have a grid with values only at the points that have been affected from a source. Since there is no stencil kernel update happening, there is no actual wave propagation, but only a few points that have been that are not zero anymore. For example, you can see in this figure A some sources that are off the grid and how they affect some points respectively for each of them. Here you can see with the black circle here, these points have been affected from source injection. What we do is we need to create a new sources structure, that is aligned to the point. So actually we should be decomposing the wave amplitude of figure A here to the wave amplitude that exists in sources in figure D, where these sources are aligned with the grid position. For this specific purpose, we create a new two structures, a source mask, which is actually a binary mask, with 0 or 1, depending on whether a point has been affected from a source, and the source with a unique ID, the so-called source IDs, where holds a unique ID for each point that has been affected. These affected points will now have the same number, will now be the same number of sources of our new structure. So we decompose our initial sources, and in the end we have a new number of sources of decomposed ones that is equal to the number of points that have been affected. You can see some pseudocode also on the bottom left part of your screen. Then we need to fuse these two iteration spaces, because now we are able to get rid of the source iteration space, and since the sources are aligned to the grid points, we can iterate through them using the grid coordinates. The interaction mapping has changed, but we can still use the interactions, the new ones, that are now on the point. Using the aligned structure, we fuse the source injection loop inside the kernel update iteration space. So we keep the time loop, the X and the Y loop, and then there is a new Z loop that is nested under the Y loop to do just the source injection update. Source mask defines whether we should add or not the new decomposed source value that is indirected through the source ID structure that we saved in the previous step. So this also helps to possibly arise CMD opportunities on some platforms. However, it is clear that we have been iterating the whole Z dimension here. This is a huge waste of cycles, a huge waste of computations, because sparse mask is incredibly sparse. Source mask is incredibly sparse, and a lot of zero multiplications will be happening here. So for example, here, you can see a typical example of this sparsity that I just mentioned here. There's no point to be executing a lot of unnecessary computations. So for this specific reason, we create a new structure called number of non-zeros mask, where we aggregate the non-zeros values along the z-axis, as well as a new reduced size sparse SID structure that will be holding the unique IDs only for the X and Y slices that have non-zero Z elements. This will help us to reduce the size of the iteration space, and instead of iterating through the whole Z dimension, we are now able to do only the necessary computations, and using the new structures, we are able to decompose, we are able to use the decomposed sources to inject into our field without having the need to use masks anymore, because we are doing only the necessary number of computations. So we came up starting from the listing one, where we had two iteration spaces, the space one, the space, the grid coordinates, as well as the sources iteration space, while now we only have the grid coordinates, and we only have the grid coordinates that are injecting to our fields through the second set innermost loop. We have the same operation count, and we also have all opportunities for parallelism and vectorization as before. And now it's our time to apply temporal blocking that is now applicable because we have managed to align the effect of the sparse of the grid operators to the grid points. For our proof of concept, we are going to use the wavefront temporal blocking scheme that is propagating the waves in tiles. So depending on whether we are able to compute some points in the future, we decide whether or not to proceed in the next tile, next wave. This is also true for staggered grids. Because, for example, as an elastic case, that is a system of coupled equations, where depending on the that dependence distance vector between them, we are able to compute elements in different, in more than one grids. The final figure here shows a listing which is showing the final form of our wave propagation kernel. It's a wavefront temporal blocking scheme with source injection aligned to the grid, inlined to the grid coordinates traversing to iteration spaces. And we have managed so far to apply temporal blocking to a class of stences, which this has been very challenging. For our experimental evaluation, we use the following three models: an isotropic acoustic case, very well known, Laplacian-like with low operational density; the isotropic elastic, which is a coupled system of vectorial and tensorial partial differential equations; nine grids, nine fields, an explosive source, a lot of data movement, and it's first order in time; and an isotropic acoustic with second order in time for industrial applications, a rotated Laplacian, all of them for 512 cubic grids and 512 milliseconds of simulation time with damping fields and absorbing boundary conditions. We did the experimental evaluation over Azure virtual machines, Broadwell architecture, and Skylake architecture. You can see the characteristics on the table on the bottom left of your screen. And the performance has been satisfactory for space order 4 and space order 8, ranging from 1.3 to 1.6 for space order 4, depending on the model, and around 1.1, 1.15 for the acoustic and elastic in Broadwell, and acoustic and TTI in Skylake, while for space order 12 we had almost no speed up. It was all it was like level, and this is expected because temporal blocking is not expected to be performing for high space orders due to the fact that asymptotically it tends to look like space blocking. We tried both GC and IC compilers, thread pinning enabled, dynamic OpenMP, parallelism and CMD vectorization. And of course, this was aggressive auto-tuning for both our temporal blocking scheme concerning the tile parameters and the block parameters, as well as the automatically generated code from Devito that was highly optimized, specially blocked, vectorized C code. And here we also illustrate a CASA-aware roofline model that shows the improvement coming from a specific block to temporal blocking that we break, that we are able to break the L3 bandwidth roofline on the Broadwell virtual machine. Similar ones exist for the Skylake as well. These are our conclusions. So we presented the approach to apply temporal blocking on a class of stencil kernels with sparse over the grid operators. All of this had a negligible cost. It was a solution built on top of the Devito domain-specific language. We had satisfactory performance gains, and this work has been presented. Has not been presented; is inherited from this paper, and you can find that online. Our future plans include integration automation and extension to graphical processing units, and to find a solution to improve high-order stencils. Thank you very much, and I would love to hear your questions.